Welcome. So today we're going to talk about cognification, which is probably a term that's not used normally in a lot of ways. But the reason we're using cognification in the sense of the digital revolution is that it's a more expansive term and covers actually several other things that we're going to be talking about. Most of the time when you hear of things, you hear of things like AI, artificial intelligence. But it's actually a much broader category than that. So I want to make sure that we go into the broadest sense of what that encompasses so that you know the differences when you hear different terms as we move forward. So let's take a look at the differences, shall we? So when we look at different artificial intelligence levels, there's different terminology that gets used. And sometimes there's crossover with people who aren't quite understanding the differences. In the general case, like when you see in Hollywood and on movies, when you think of artificial intelligence, they're talking about a sentient intelligence, something that's equivalent of an artificial version of the human being consciousness. That is not something that we're really at as far as any type of technological level. That would be under consideration of artificial general intelligence, or AGI. This is where a system responds to its surroundings. Not only does it learn, but it can adapt and maybe indistinguishable from an average human intelligence, and has the ability to be self-aware. As yet, there is nothing on the market or in the research world that's even approached to that level yet. It doesn't mean there aren't groups that are trying. There definitely are, and we'll talk about some of that. And one of the issues that even philosophers and ethicists really talk about is, should we be doing this? Should we even be trying to do this? And this is where you hear a lot of the controversy that lights up from everyone, from Elon Musk, who's trying to democratize AI using open AI portals and things like that, or other groups that are trying to take different approaches. Say, should we really be trying to make an artificial general intelligence who then would be competing with humans? So, and there's a lot of rationale is like, should we be doing something like that? So, and then others argue that it's inevitable that we're going to be doing that, and that's just part of the progression of life. So there's these issues, and when they talk about a singularity, that is where a self-awareness of a consciousness would be, realizing that it is aware, and now it becomes something new, like a new life form in a way. So that's kind of what they talk about when we're talking about artificial general intelligence. But again, that's not what's in the market, and that's not what's going on right now. Most of what we see now are versions of these other three things: artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. They're all different facets of the same aspect, but they usually are reserved for specific versions of what's going on. So artificial intelligence, and actually many of these, are based upon neural networks, and we'll talk about neural networks. And this is technology that's been around since the 50s of last century. Started back then and then got into the 60s and 70s, and they started building on it and kept growing on neural networks. And the whole idea here is biomimicry, really, where we're modeling how we perceive that our brains work and the neurons work through mathematical models and programming languages. And so that's really what they're trying to do, is mimic how we think that our brains work in a computer, in a machine. So that's really what we're trying to do. So some of the things that we've been getting especially good at is image recognition, pattern recognition, so that you can actually use it. That's what they use in automated driving, particularly, so that you can be aware of your surroundings and see what's going on. But they're still using really large data sets to do these types of things. And when we mean really large data sets, we're talking like hundreds of thousands to millions of points of data to learn maybe a specific thing. They're usually defined in a really narrow area. Same with machine learning. Now, machine learning is a little bit different context. It uses statistical methods that they combine with these neural networks to make predictions and try to figure out what outcomes would be. So you can process through these neural networks, but then you got to decide to do something. And that's kind of where machine learning can tie in with these statistical methods. However, when you do that, you're usually talking about a wide range of statistics. And again, you're really talking about heavy, heavy processing. But it does improve with experience as you go through that. Another version is deep learning, and this is where instead of light-level neural networks, we're actually going to use deep-layered neural networks, and I'll talk about that in the next slide, about what that means. The idea here is that we can learn faster and use smaller data sets, because really they're trying to optimize, all right, if we don't want to use a million points of data, or we don't have access to a million points of data, how can we use less data and get equal or better than outcomes? So that's kind of where deep learning falls under. But to really understand any of this, we really have to kind of understand what's a neural network. And again, we're trying to mimic what the human brain does. So let's take, for example, a very simple model. We're going to have a node. We're going to call that like a neuron, okay? And the neuron has inputs, x1, x2. And these inputs have initial weights. So let's say between weight 1 and weight 2, that they have to sum up to a value of 1 or 100%. So we're going to give a 60% weight to weight 1. We're going to give a 40% to weight 2. Sounds a lot like analyses that we do anyway for decision making, where we weight and prioritize different things and give them a score. That's really what's going on here. Then we go to the function of the node. Now, the function of the neuron actually comes in several parts before it gives an output of y, of the interpretation. In the first piece, let's take a look at this. This component right here, even though it says a function of e, this can be a limited network where it's not very deep, or it can be a very deep network, like a deep learning network. And so this is just an example of not a deep network, but a light layered neural network. So this function of E is actually several functions. So there's actually multiple nodes underneath here. So if you notice, this node is now represented by 6 nodes. And we still have the same inputs, x1, x2, and the output y. Now, the output for y is going to be the function of all of these inputs as it comes in. And each of these is also going to have a function to it. So if you notice, these 3 nodes take the input from x1 with varied weights, and also they all take the input from x2 of varied weights. And then there's also a function between here. Likewise, this layer is going to take the outputs of these as inputs, and there's going to be weights on these as well. And then it's going to come back out to here. Eventually, you get to the point where you get to the end, and there's going to be some error. And then what you do is then you adapt the network based upon that error. So you recalculate all these weights and some of these functions to then go at it again. So you iterate and you iterate and iterate, and eventually the system gets more and more optimized. So if you think about it as a neural network version of an optimization algorithm, that's really what we're trying to do. So we usually, in this case, we have a target of what we want. So based upon the information you have, if you know what a known good is or what your optimum is, that's what you're trying to target. That's very easy to train a network with some confined inputs. But without that constraint, it gets very difficult, because if it's an open-ended and you don't know what the optimum is, these systems tend to not perform well at all, because they really don't know what you're trying to do or what you're trying to target, which is different. That's more like open-ended learning. So the other aspect, if we want to break this down even further, is if you look at the beginning, there's a summing junction at any one of these components. And that's, again, that's where we have each of the input values multiplied by a weight. So these are a product, and it's a sum of products. That's really all it is. It's pretty basic when you put it down mathematically. And then that input could go through a modifier function, which sometimes they'll add nonlinear elements, sometimes they won't. It just depends upon the application. And this is, again, this is one variety of a linear version versus a circular architecture. And then they have oftentimes an activation function. So in other words, maybe you have to get beyond a certain threshold for then the output to propagate to the next level. So maybe maybe our threshold's 70%, let's say. And maybe node 1 here and node 2 go beyond that, so then they send out their signals to the next layer. But maybe node 3 does not pass that threshold, and those thresholds are adjustable as however we want. And so it does not proliferate a signal moving on. In that case, you won't get a contribution from this node in the sense, or it would be like a zero contribution to the summing network for the next one. But these will dominate that. And it kind of mimics the ability of neurons to make connections and or disconnect depending upon their use and how they operate. So again, it's really interesting because we're kind of just trying to mimic mathematically what we note in biology, in our brains and in neural network systems that are natural. And that's really the basics of how it goes. Now, you can spend entire class, you can get a master's degree in these types of things and do research in this to really go into it deeply. But that's the basics so that you can fundamentally understand when you're talking to people who are dive into these AI networks and how they work. You can have an understanding on how to comprehend what they're doing. Now, the fundamental problem with a lot of these things is you can't see oftentimes what's going on, particularly if you have deep layered networks. Then it's kind of like a black box. You don't really know what it's doing or how it's making decisions. And it can make really wrong decisions, and then you have a problem because you don't really know how to diagnose or correct if something's going on. And so that's one of the fundamental drawbacks of this approach. So let's look at, see how specifically these types of systems are used. So applied AI, remember, these are very narrow applications. So they're optimization algorithms, if you think about it like that, that self-optimize. That's really what it is. It's an adaptive optimization algorithm for specific things. And again, you have to have good input, good data to train the system, and you have to have a pretty solid outcome, knowing what you want, so that you know what you're optimizing to. If you don't have those things, again, these things have a problem. They don't work well. But there are a lot of places where we have made good use. Probably the most common one is the one right here in the center, natural language processing. We're taking in language. We have tons of experts to know what the language should look like, how the words should be pronounced, how they should sound, and also the language structure and rules. So we have a lot of people who have done this. Plus, it's easy to do in a program language if you consider you can type things in, or you can input words that are already digitized. And really, it's basically mastering the interpretation of strings, which is how we input words into computer language anyway, and then coming out with a string of language on the output. Machine learning, we're also using to analyze data, expert systems, which again is you're trying to take expert ideas of optimums and what you're doing and rules of what's the best approach, and then trying to encapsulate that in code. Conversational, which actually leads back to natural language processing and also actually audio processing. So when you use an Alexa or you use a Google Pod or any of those things, it's actually trying to understand what you're saying in the terms of the natural language processing. So it's converting the audio into words, and then once it has the words, now it's using natural language processing to interpret what you want. And then it does a spit out of what you want. And there may be some machine learning on the back end of that to try to figure out what it is you want. Robotics, we'll talk more about that because now you're talking about incorporating AI algorithms into a system that has mobility. So instead of just talking to a computer that's stationary in some database in Timbuktu somewhere where you don't even know where the cloud processing is happening, this is actually trying to make something a little bit more self-contained, something that is a little bit more like what we see in sci-fi. And we'll show an example of that. Computer vision, this is huge right now. They're using this in all sorts of ways to recognize people's faces. For better or worse, you see this a lot in China where, you know, they're trying to do face recognition and nail people if they cross the street in the wrong way and publicly shame them and automatically goes against your social credit. So that's, you know, that's pretty authoritarian. So in my opinion, so I think that's a little bit too far. But you see that in a lot of cases, and then they'll use that to look up for criminal records. They'll use it, and I say they in a general sense, but you can use computer vision for good things too. I mean, some people are already using it to log into their phones for security, or maybe it's when you don't want everybody going into, you know, a highly sensitive area, you can use facial recognition And autonomous agents. So this is another thing where you're using automata algorithms along with AI. And this gets increasingly used in a lot of areas in business. So this is why when we talk about the digital transformation of business, it's because we're starting to use all that we're learning over the past 50 years in computer science into the business models. Anything from corporate strategy, marketing, engagement, customer service, finance, HR, supply chain, risk management, all these things we're starting to use some versions of AI. And we'll have some other speakers coming in later to talk about that. This is actually from the American Institute of Artificial Intelligence, which, by the way, is a company. It's not a nonprofit, even though it sounds a little bit like it. It's a .com, and they kind of have this copyrighted idea, but it actually is very pertinent to what actually is happening. In some way, to make a decision, you're having something sense, having some data come in, some input data, could be in, it could be audio, visual, data, you name it. So that's the sense piece. You analyze, maybe you're using some machine learning. You make a decision based upon that. And again, that could be between analyze and decide, some AI, machine learning, deep learning combination. Then you act. Now it's an actuation. So now you've decided, now you're going to do something. And then you learn from what you did. Very, very similar to what we do every day. So if you want more information, you can learn more about that as well. Okay, so some of the off-the-shelf integrators, because, yeah, you could go and build this stuff yourself and hire a whole bunch of programmers to do that. One, it's very hard to get talent right now. It's increasingly difficult because the competition for people who can program well in AI, machine learning, deep learning, are at a premium right now. So if you want a job where you can be making six figures, get really good at those types of areas. The other thing is then you have to understand how to manage that process, and you have to have the capital to be able to develop that and integrate it with your systems. Many firms are not equipped to do that, particularly if their business really isn't that this is just something that would accentuate, speed up their business, make it more efficient, lower their HR costs, all these kinds of things. So there are alternatives. There are experts that have created companies that specialize in helping you with your company. So this actually is a huge resource. So what you're seeing is the specialists are now helping a whole bunch of other companies integrate systems. And you can go from a full integration of systems, everything through your inventory, almost like an ERM using AI, all the way down to just certain things like a customer service type bot. So these are just some examples. So folks who do enterprise AI, I just gave one of each, but there's many, many more. C3 AI, so you can actually go to their link there and check them out. They do full suite of enterprise management, customer relationship management, inventory, predictive maintenance, energy management, anti-money laundering, all these kinds of things. So they use a lot of machine learning involved in that. So they will help you in all those different aspects of the business, of course, for a significant price. So, but if you're a medium to large organization and you really want to do that, they might be the provider that would be good. There's also HR. And maybe this is for being able to hire people, and you want to be able to go through a whole bunch of applications quickly and really have that. Well, it turns out there's a local player here in Arizona called paradox.ai that has a text-based assistant for candidate hiring in HR. We'll learn more about that. Custom-built consulting. So this is IntellectSoft. So they do software development platforms. They can incorporate cognitive computing modules using AI-ML combinations. They have a bit of experience in blockchain, user experience, user interface. So this is actually somebody who will come in and you have a custom problem, they'll develop a custom solution for you. So they're truly a consultant firm to come in and help you build what you need, not just give you stuff that's off the shelf that they have already developed, but they will use blocks of things that they've optimized several times before. So there's a variety of ways you can get your business involved in this space and innovate your business through this digital transformation without having to bring everything in-house at the time. Now, even if you do start doing that, you probably do want to have at some point a handoff where you have somebody who can help maintain what's going on and be able to communicate effectively and understand what's actually being implemented in your company. So you want to at least have some people in your system that can help you do that. Okay, so let's look at some of the more fun aspects of what's going on. There's a lot of experimentation and different things. So interacting social robots. So these are robots that they're trying to emotionally connect with people. So one of the more famous ones right now is Sophia by Hanson Robotics. Now, Hanson actually came out of Disney with a lot of the automation technology that they had at Disney. So he really has an understanding of how to automate and animate. Combine that with some AI. And so they do human expressions. And it's still a little rough around the edges, but they started Sophia back in 2016, and they've had a lot of public events, everything from Saudi Arabia to other types of things, where they actually go to the Tonight Show. So you can check that out too. But check out any of the links that I've got here in the presentation. So, and that's one step. So now, the elephant in the room for a lot of people, though, is artificial general intelligence and this race to trying to develop. And there's really two different directions that I see happening here. You have a private direction where people want to develop it and then capitalize on it. And that's the private sector. Then you have the other, which is more like a public sector or distributed idea. So probably the most famous one right now with Google is Alphabet's DeepMind. AlphaGo was one of those projects, and it uses deep learning. And one of the things that they've been working on is how to develop this AlphaGo system. And AlphaGo beat the world champion player at Go, which they thought was kind of the end-all be-all, much faster than anybody anticipated. And the important thing that's different here, it's not using brute statistical approaches, which is the way things used to work. So, for example, with Jeopardy and IBM's Watson, early on it was all statistical-based, statistical approaches, but that's actually changed quite a lot now that they're doing deep reinforcement in neural networks that they're trying to make generalized. So that's a very different approach in how they're doing it. But the fact that it beat the world champion as fast as it did was way faster than they predicted, almost a decade faster. The other thing that take a note in is they're also doing training with a whole bunch of different amateur games using pixel imaging. So, for example, Space Invaders or early Atari games, they had this system go through and start playing these games. Well, it got so good at it that you could have it start learning a game in the morning, and by the afternoon, because it would be playing itself over and over and over again, that the system would beat anybody on the planet at that game at that point in time. Now, keep in mind, this is not a system that is physically moving a controller like you and I would. It has direct access to making moves digitally, so it also can actuate at the speed of light or speed of electrons. So that's a little bit different. So there's some of those delays that we would have is because we're physically controlling something through a game controller. But that should be a little bit alarming in the sense that now they have this thing, it can play, you know, 100 games and it could beat everybody at the same time playing these games. And then they've already demonstrated that. But again, it's still a very focused application. The thing that makes it a little bit more alarming is that they've given the rules of the game and then this thing learns how to win really fast by playing itself. So there is an AI ethics board that's really got put into place as soon as Google acquired this, because actually this was an acquisition that they did. They didn't actually develop it initially inside. So it's something worth looking at. It's something that is some people are a little bit alarmed by. Think about it. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit now about an alternative. So that's going in a privatized manner. And they're not the only ones, but they're kind of one of the high profile ones. A different one uses a completely different approach. And I like to bring up these folks because they also come with a different philosophy on what they think the role of AI should be in society. So there's a twofer here. In one sense, they're actually not using neural networks. It doesn't use the same ontology at all. They have a patented system that they've had for about a decade now, using a canonical approach to AI. And so this system works entirely different, and we'll talk more about it on the next slide. But they have this system now where it started learning books using natural language. It started with a little prince and is now moving to more advanced stuff. And their concept here, their whole motivation is to have AI for the people and have it democratized and distributed so that it's available to anybody, not just to big corporations, not just to governments or anything like that, because they see that the danger of having any one of those systems having it could be catastrophic. So the other thing that they do really interestingly is they're leveraging another technology, the blockchain that we talked about, in order to make this system distributed across the entire network. So they're really combining blockchain, AI, big data. They want it to be open, and they also are having a safety engine of separation, so essentially a kill switch, so that if they can separate the ontologies, the information from the engine, so that you can only use the engine as needed, but you can't have this thing take off by itself overall. So it's a really interesting concept. They're called mind.ai. Let's take a better look at what they're really talking about here. So with mind.ai, again, they have these ontologies, and this is going to go, this next video will go a little bit into the ontologies and actually how it works. But I wanted to show the overall structure of how they're looking at it. So you can have a database of these ontologies, these canonicals, like they show down here. And these will have things that are off-chain and on-chain. So on-chain are then the ones that are used for anybody who wants to have access to it. So it's crowdsourced. So people can build up this database and this blockchain of on-chain things. So users will actually get to be able to build these ontologies. So what's kind of neat about that is because it's on blockchain, you can't stop them. So you can keep growing the database and having everybody crowdsource to be able to do something with this. So if you think about this, this is like the brain structure. Okay, we build this brain structure where everybody has access to it. Now, they use crypto exchanges where you get access to be able to be a user and build this up. Then you can also create distributed applications that make use of the canonicals. So, and this is where you can have, say, a finance app that you want to use, but you want to make your next decision on what to invest in. You can actually use an ontology to give you some advice. Or maybe it's a customer service thing. And then so developers would be working on this. And again, this Ohm AI is their cryptocurrency that they're actually using to be able to convert from any fiat currency into a currency that gets used here. So this in this way, they keep this thing diversified and user-friendly for anybody in the world, which was actually pretty insightful to make that jump early on. The other thing then is the mind engine, the one that actually is doing all the operations. So this is the one that's making use of all the canonicals to make those predictions for any of these distributed applications. And so this is the thing almost as a generalized intelligence. Once it has access to the canonicals, it can do all these types of things. But they put a limiter on it with this little guy here, what they call a kill switch, so that they can keep a degree of separation from the engine so you can get the advantages of AI and all the benefits without necessarily making something that becomes self-conscious and that can start overrunning the internet on its own, so that we actually have a control over that. You can look them up. There's actually several other videos that are that are on them as well, and be able to learn a lot about it. So, all right, so that was a lot. I'm going to call it a day for this, for the AI talk, and we'll talk about a different aspect of digital transformation next time. All right, thanks.